These videos are offered on a pay-what-you-like basis. You can pay for the use of the videos at my website. There is a link to my website in the info box. The address is www.freelance-teacher.com/videos.htm, or you can just use the link in the info box. By the way, I also offer tutoring via Skype, and you can find more information about that Skype tutoring service at my website. Thanks. So we know that the electrons are arranged around the nucleus in shells. The electrons are arranged in shells. So we need to give some names to the shells. The names of the shells are not very creative. They're 1, 2, 3, and 4. So we just use numbers to name the shells. And then we need what's called a quantum number to be the variable that can take on these various numbers. So do you remember, what's the variable that designates what shell you're in?
N.
Yeah, that's N. The name for this is the principal quantum number. So all the principal quantum number tells you is which shell you're in. The principal quantum number tells you which shell you're in. First shell, second shell, third shell. Which of these shells, roughly speaking, is closest to the nucleus? But then it turns out that each of these shells can be split into subshells. The shells can be split into subshells. So we need to have names that we can give to those subshells as well. Do you remember what the names are that are given to the subshells? The shells are called 1, 2, 3, and 4. What the subshells are called?
Is that S and P?
Yeah, S, P, D, and F. The subshells are S, P, D, and F. Now, how many subshells does each shell have? Well, it turns out to be a very simple pattern. The first shell has one subshell. The second shell has two subshells. The third shell has three subshells. And the fourth shell has four subshells. What subshells does the first shell have?
S.
And what subshells does the second shell have?
SP.
Good. What about here?
SP.
And here?
SPD.
Good. Now, the significance of this solid line here is there are these are the only subshells. For example, the first shell does not have a P subshell, and the second shell does not have a D subshell, and the third shell does not have an F subshell. Now, of course, there are more shells than subshells if you go down to the fifth shell, but these are the only ones that exist in the first four shells. All right, now we could call the subshells S, P, D, and F, but if we want to be mathematical, we'd like to give numbers to the subshells. We'd like to have a variable that stands for those numbers. So do you remember, what's the variable that stands for the numbers for the subshells? We know that N stands for the numbers for the shells. Do you remember so now we need another quantum number. Quantum number that stands for the numerical designations for the subshells.
When you say M, you say O.
So this number is going to be L. And what number do we assign to this first subshell? Well, it might seem logical to say that the first subshell S should be 1,
zero.
But actually they decided to be, I don't know, weird or super logical and call it 0. And then what number would we give to P? And D and F. Now remember that N was the principal quantum number. So there should be a name for L too, but I forget what it is. Is that the angular momentum quantum number? The orbital quantum number. I don't really like that name. All right, your textbook calls it the orbital quantum number, but I don't know. I don't like that name. All right, but that's the orbital quantum number. I think sometimes it's called the angular momentum quantum number because it quantizes the angular momentum. That's a slightly better name. But the most logical name would be the subshell number. It tells us what subshell we're in. Just like N tells us what shell we're in. So let's say that we are in the third shell. What are the possible subshells that the electron could be in?
0, 1, 2.
Yeah, what's the variable that stands for those numbers?
L.
Yeah, L could be 0, 1, or 2. And what would be the letters that would be assigned to that?
S, yeah. I'm S, D, P, P, F, S, P, D.
Yeah, so here's the order right here. S, P, D, and F. So those could be S, P, or D. In the third shell, the electron could be in any of these three subshells. So how about when n is 2 in the second shell, what are the possible subshells that the electron could be in here?
So 1 and 0.
Yeah, and what's the letter that stands for these numbers?
S and P.
Yeah. And the letter that stands for these numbers is L. Okay. So one thing we can see here is that the L's do not go up to the n for any particular subshell. It goes to n minus 1. So the way the mathematicians would write this is L can be anywhere from 0 to n minus 1. A common type of problem, there's a problem like this in your homework, is to be given a whole bunch of quantum numbers, and you have to say which ones are impossible. So you give you a whole bunch of quantum numbers, you have to say which ones are impossible. Well, it's impossible if L is equal to n, because it can only go up to n minus 1. Now, in general, I think it's a little bit better to try to avoid focusing too much on mathematical formulas here and go a little bit more for understanding. So I tend not to focus on this too much. I'd just say, just based on what we've seen here with our little table here, if we know these are the possible subshells, and we know that the numbering starts with 0, so that should make it pretty clear who's possible here. But this is the way many people learn this. They just memorize that L can go from 0 to n minus 1. So, is this possible or impossible?
Impossible.
Is this possible or impossible?
Impossible.
Yeah. Now this is the one that really messes people up. This seems okay because these numbers are equal. But because the numbering for the subshell starts at 0, L can only go up to n minus 1. Is this possible?
Yeah.
Yeah. L can go up to n minus 1. If L equals 3, what would be the letter that corresponds to that subshell?
D.
Take your time.
Oh,
F. You were probably thinking it's the third subshell,
yeah.
But it actually is the fourth. You can see how it's really easy to get mistakes here. If I was taking the test, I would just write this down and just use this. S is 0, P is 1, D is 1, F, D is 2, and F is 3. Because otherwise it's very easy to say, oh, the D is the third subshell, so its number should be 3. Now, since we start the numbering at 0, the third subshell actually has the number of 2. Well, the easiest way to avoid that mistake is just to write down this little table. So when L equals 3, we're actually in the F subshell. Would this be possible?
Yeah.
How about this?
Yeah.
How about this?
Yeah.
How about this? No. L can never be negative, because this is the smallest that L could be. So this would also be impossible. Why would anyone think that L could be negative? Well, because in a second we'll learn about other quantum numbers that can be negative. There are some quantum numbers that can be negative, but L can never be negative. What would be the letter here?
D.
And here.
P.
And here.
S.
Well, you can see there's nothing for negative one to stand for here. All right, so L has to go up to, from 0 to n minus 1. It can't be negative. So what's the smallest that L could ever be?
0.
What's the smallest that n could ever be?
1.
Yeah. So L starts at 0, but the n's start at 1. That's another thing to watch out for.